Okay, welcome back, everybody. This week we are talking about terrorism technology and the accountability of police in the future, of police too. I am your commentator, Dr. Richard Stringer. I hope you already read the chapter on this, so I'm going to go through some high points and see if I have anything to add on a few of these things. And this is the last lecture of this class, so keep in mind that you will have your final exam next week, so study for that. All right, so we first start with the idea that we began at the beginning of class talking about the history of police, and well, since the history was relevant then, it's relevant now too. And one of the things to keep in mind is that crisis has kind of always been the thing that led to change in the police. From the different eras of political reform, community problem solving, what I consider to be the militarization era, and then, now we might be moving into another type of reform era, given all that's going on with police legitimacy. So we might see that in the future. We're also seeing continued concerns about terrorism and things like that, although that's, I think, waned down a little bit in recent years, but it's still going. And so, with regard to terrorism, that is one of the new demands on police that we have to worry about, that police are concerned about and going to have to deal with, and will probably continue to have to deal with in the future. Just to give you all a little bit of background on terrorism. Domestic terrorism usually involves people in our own country. Obviously, international terrorism would involve people from abroad. You have your right-wing terrorists, your neo-Nazis, people who have racism, the KKK. I think we've got some people over here. We have homophobia, anti-Semitism, and stuff like that. And we've got some far right-wing people nowadays, with the Proud Boys and other people like that that some people might consider to be terrorist groups, but I'm not going to go there. International terrorism as terrorists who act, and occurs and are the natural origin of the person who committed it are foreign, so they're from another country, like I said. They're often motivated by extreme religious views and hatred of the United States. So people don't seem to like the United States very much. State-sponsored terrorism. This is a type of terrorism when someone is terrorist is working in collaboration with some sort of government, terrorist organization, things like that. And then you have your lone wolf terrorist. Lone wolf terrorists are often the most difficult to track and get intel on and things like that because it's just one person. It's much easier to track a large network of terrorists who talk to each other and communicate than it is just one person. They're much more likely to fly under the radar, which makes them much more difficult to prevent them from doing things. In recent years, we've seen also concerns with cyber terrorism. Many police departments are poorly equipped to deal with that, and many patrol officers don't really see it as part of their job. However, in recent years, and probably in the future, this will become even more prolific. Departments are starting to create cyber terror or cyber crime units who do nothing but deal with that. They spend a lot of their time, obviously, in an office at a desk on a computer, doing these sorts of things. And this is gets into kind of how they will find pedophiles through, chat rooms and stuff like that, the Dateline NBC stuff. Of course, that's not the police, that's the Dateline NBC people. But anyway, so these all present some new demands for the police with regard to terrorism, the new technology of having the internet. Also, a new demand is going to be accountability. Frankly, I think this should have been a demand all the time, but it's become More prolific these days, especially with the advent of technological advances, such as everybody having a smartphone that is capable of recording things, as well as surveillance cameras all over the place. And now we see that many departments are starting to require officers to wear body cameras to document what's going on, which holds not only the officers accountable, but holds suspects and people they interact with accountable. And I tell you, those cameras, if I haven't told you already, they work both ways. They can catch officers doing things wrong. They can also exonerate officers. They can actually be brought in as evidence of someone's guilt, too, of a citizen's guilt. So these things are very important pieces of information and evidence that we're going to see more and more of. So, could these things represent a crisis enough to change policing in America? I suppose only time will tell. We will see what will happen. So your book makes some predictions about, what's going to happen. I think I've kind of alluded to, particularly with evidence and intelligence-based policing, that that's going to be kind of the wave of the future. That's kind of my opinion, that that is going to become far more prolific. So if that's something that you're interested in getting into, I would highly recommend, you get into learning about how all these things, data analytics and things like that, because not only the it's a skill that not everyone has, it's a marketable skill, and the better you are at it, the more you're going to be able to write your own ticket to do whatever you want. We've got a One of our graduate students actually came from the IT field, and he's working with Cherokee County Sheriff's Office, and he's helping them to find the pedophiles and things like that through the internet and through gathering intel on them. And he said, "I'm only going to do this if you deputize me and allow me to go out and actually arrest them." So he's been deputized, and now he does all this stuff and then gets to go arrest the bad guys. So, those are things that are possibilities. The Patriot Act of 2001, your book talks about that, giving new power to law enforcement agencies. I believe that the Patriot Act has been allowed to lapse a few years ago, so we don't really have to worry about that so much anymore unless they reinstate it. Also, citizens are going to remain important. You got this quote up here from DHS: "If you see something, say something." And I think we need to remember that from community-oriented policing, that the police can't be everywhere, and having citizens, cooperative citizens, that can help out to provide intel is going to be crucial towards combating terrorism and crime in general, with information sources, tip lines, etc. So those are all things that I think are going to be important too. I've already kind of said how, intel-led policing is going to become better defined and developed, and it's going to become much more prolific. Militarization, increased use of military tactics and blurring the lines between the police and military. I've got, I think there were some videos back in the history, of police section that talked about military or militarization of police, and how that really kind of evolved out of the Waco shootings as well as the North Hollywood shootout. A lot of people think it's from 9/11. I don't know that, I don't think that hurt. It probably helped to move the situation along, but militarization was already beginning before that because of the Waco shootout and the North Hollywood shootout, which you can watch the documentaries on those in D2L and in the history section if you haven't already. And the accountability is going to be another big one for police officers. Police officers are going to be much more accountable to what they do. It's going to make their job a little bit tougher because they're going to know that everything that they do is going to have the potential to be reviewed and be called out on. So that's another important piece of accountability, which would be kind of new to the police profession that we haven't really had so much. Technology of accountability. The first one, I think, is going to be body cameras. Two reasons that they're going to be effective is officers are going to be aware that they're being recorded. They're not going to engage in illegal activity if they know they're being recorded. I think I talked about in one of the earlier lectures about how I think it's important to tell suspects that they're being recorded as well, because there is something known as reactivity, as also known as the Hawthorne effect in psychology, that people will behave differently when they know they're being watched. They behave differently when they know they're being recorded. And so officers and civilians might be less likely to be hostile towards each other, maybe would be more cooperative if they know that, you know, if they do anything wrong, if someone's not going to tell the jury or the judge about it, like it's going to be video illustrated. Provide strong evidence of one way or the other of what actually happened. GPS showing locations in real time. A lot of departments already have this to show where police cars and police officers are all the time. National Police Misconduct Reporting Program, they're trying to work on this in the National Use of Force Database. We don't really have it up and running yet. The big limitation to it, I think, is going to be that it's voluntary. Departments don't have to submit data to it, and I think that the most problematic departments are probably going to be the ones that don't want to submit that data. In order for it to get any kind of real traction, I think, you know, they're not. I don't think there's any way they can make it mandatory. Then again, they could make it legal, pass a law, I guess. But one of the an easier way than that would be to put some sort of financial incentive behind it. You know, we'll give you this money for body cameras if you will, you know, submit your use of force data to this system. And early intervention systems go along with that. You know, I've helped the DEA and various other agencies pour through their data and use predictive models to be able to predict what the DEA were predicting, what we call pill mills of doctors that would go through and write way more prescriptions than everybody else did. But you can do this, and I've helped departments do this with use of force data or civilian complaints, and find those officers that are statistically outliers that get way more complaints than everybody else does. You know, there's other factors you have to control for in that statistical model, such as like their age and what part of town they're assigned to, whether they're working the night shift or the day shift and things like that, because that can all impact it. But once you control for all of those things and you held them all constant, if this person is still getting way more complaints, way more use of force issues than other people, then there might be some sort of need to intervene there. And possibly, you know, in many instances, can be resolved through training, but sometimes not. You know, and sometimes you really have to fight that that Dirty Harry phenomenon, so to speak. You know, I talked about that last class, and I think, or no, it's been a few lectures ago now. But, you know, if the department isn't on board, then it's not going to change. I know one, I think I forgot to mention this in the lecture earlier, but another example of the Dirty Harry phenomenon, and this was like a departmental level Dirty Harry phenomenon, I guess, was a department up north, which I won't name, but they had a policy that it was an unwritten policy. They just did it, and it was kind of handed down from above, but that they would search any car that they wanted to, regardless of if they had probable cause or not. They would ask if it was, especially if it was a young person, they would ask to search their car, and then if they, you know, they said no, they would just search the car anyway. And they didn't care so much if the, you know, the evidence got thrown out because it was an illegal search or whatever, because their rationale was, well, even if the case gets thrown out, if they search a car and they find illegal guns and drugs and stuff like that, you don't get that stuff back. So their rationale was, look, I might be conducting an illegal search and I might not be able to get them to be convicted because of, you know, my questionable search practices, but at least I'm getting these guns and drugs off the street. And that's, I think, a great example of of the Dirty Harry phenomenon too. That I didn't talk about that in that lecture, but I gave you some other examples, but it just popped into my head. Anyway, and so looking at that would be important, right? These early intervention systems are important as well, with people like that officers that commit these heinous acts of brutality. Most of the time, if not all times, they've had previous complaints, usually several of them. And so an early intervention system would be able to identify those officers, such as Derek Chauvin, who he'd never killed anybody that we know of, but he had had several instances of excessive force before that. An early intervention system would have picked up on that and been able to do something about it if the department was willing to do anything about it. And if not, then it would have held the department accountable. So that's an important thing moving forward, to be able to identify these officers. And some people don't need to be police officers if they're doing things like that. And if we can identify those officers early, get them off the street, that's going to make everybody's life a lot better. One thing that comes to mind, and this would help a lot of the other officers' lives too, because many police officers will tell me that nobody hates a crooked police officer more than a good police officer, because they make them look bad, and it's dangerous for them, because these people, suspects that become highly combative with the police and have grudges against the police, a lot of times that comes from a place of having a lot of interactions with hostile and police officers that they perceive as illegitimate, or they don't believe in proper procedural justice, or believe that they've been harmed by those police officers. And so then that makes them hostile towards all police officers. And I think that's a bit of an overgeneralization, and it's not a proper way to generalize things, but we have to think about these things as we're thinking through all the problems that we have in policing and what's causing them and how we can solve them in the future. So I'll throw that out there for you. The technology of identification, this is going to become really big. I talked about in the last lecture, with evidence-based policing, a lot of databases that are going to be used. CODIS is where your DNA all goes. Biometrics, fingerprints, face scans, things like that. DNA intelligence is all going to be important. Automated fingerprint identification system has been used for a long time. One thing I like to point out is your textbook calls it IAFIS. Nobody else in the world does that, other than I guess the author of your textbook that I've ever heard of. Everyone else calls it AFIS. So it's automated fingerprint identification system, not integrated. And so if you call it IAFIS, people are going to look at you weird. So if you're ever talking to a police officer or intel person or someone in the field, call it AFIS. That's just the system that keeps everybody's fingerprints in there. Facial recognition systems, these are going to become important. I see that probably going to be happening soon, in the next decade or so. Because you can put mugshots and people's faces into that, wanted people, stuff like that. And then all these cameras that we've got around Atlanta and everywhere can scan for those people and alert us when they see them. License plate recognition systems have become really popular recently, and those are going to, I think, be even more so lately. One instance we had recently, the DEA will often get license plates, but they won't know what state the license plate is from. And so one of the ways through crime analytics and using a crime analyst is what you can do is go through the cameras, the traffic cameras, and you can just search for that license plate, and it'll find it if it's driven past any camera, and then you can zoom in on it, and then you can see the state that license plate has come from, and then that allows you to then run it through the system better. Most people when they take down a license plate number, they don't take down the state. And if it's not a Georgia plate, they'll automatically run it as a Georgia plate, but they can't run it through, each and every one. And so then each and every state. And so then what you do is you go and look through these things, and that's a cool way of finding out what the state is. That has been used quite a lot for the DEA. If you're interested in this crime analytics stuff, let me know, and I can put you in touch with some people. I got several of my former students that went through the graduate program are off doing that over at Marietta and different departments. Have been quite successful, and it's really neat, a neat thing to get into. You don't have to be a sworn police officer; it's a civilian job, but pays pretty good. So yeah. Anyway. Technology of seeing is going to be another thing. I think I've already mentioned the gunshot detection systems we have here in Atlanta. Unmanned aerial vehicles or drones, thermal imaging is a big one that's starting. X-ray machines are kind of old now. They don't really use those that much at the airport. It's more of the thermal imaging. Closed circuit television, CCTVs are kind of big, especially in big cities. So they can watch a whole lot of different areas and see what's going on, all from one centralized place. They're also doing, you've probably seen in Cobb County, they have these portable cameras. It's like a trailer type of thing that they move to different areas, and then it has a big pole with a camera on top of it. Sniffer technology, this is being really good for detecting bugs or cell phones and things like that. It's really quite prolific in prisons. Technology is just kind of what's going to be a lot of the future of policing. As criminals start to use more and more technology, then the police have to use more and more technology to keep up with them. I always joke that the people that make the radar detectors are also the people that make the laser guns for the police to detect your speed, the speed detectors. And so there's a constant, ebb and flow. You have to have the current, latest edition because they have new radar detectors now won't detect or that won't detect everything. But if you don't get the latest one, they have some laser blocking ones now where you can actually block the police officer's radar gun from detecting your speed. But only if you have the latest model. If you don't have the latest model, it won't work. So they're constantly playing the police departments and the speeders against each other to buy their latest markets. Anyway, I just use that as an example of kind of the police versus the speeders and technology. But as I digress. So technologies for computer and internet applications is going to be big. Cybersecurity is a huge thing. Dealing with all these keystroke loggers and these scammers and different things is just, it's become outrageous. And one of the things is, I think, is the police just haven't really kept up with it. And one of the things that's so hard from a jurisdictional perspective is for policing this type of stuff is usually the people that are doing this kind of stuff aren't in the jurisdiction where their victims are. Probably not even in the same country. So if you get somebody from China or name what other, we'll say Russia since they're being difficult lately. If someone from Russia is, keystroke logging you or scamming you or something like that, and there's really not much that the police can do to someone in Russia. They're way out of their jurisdiction, and so that's part of how they get away with that kind of stuff. So be mindful of buying things overseas, internationally, and things like that. With regard to keystroke logging and cybersecurity too. So one of the things that we do around here is every once in a while we get the CIA and I have various intel people that come in, and one of the things that the Secret Service actually shared was. One of the biggest things you can do to prevent getting these, ransomwares and things like that, and keystroke loggers and things that will kind of take over your computer, is to not use your administration account as your daily account on your computer. Use a guest account. And the reason is, is because if you get some kind of virus, you get some kind of ransomware or something like that, and you're logged in under a guest, they can't really access your system, right? Because you need administrative rights to be able to make big changes to your system. And they call the admin account kind of the keys to the castle. Because if you're logged in as an admin, they can access everything in your computer, but under a guest, they can't really do very much. And so I thought that was remarkable when I first heard that. I was like, wow, that's a great idea. And I used my admin account all the time prior to that, and now I don't do that. I have created a separate guest account, and I only use the admin if I have to, install some software or something like that. So if you don't take away anything from this class, take that away, that maybe that'll help you with computer viruses and things like that. But anyway, this is just an example of what they call an MDC, a mobile data terminal, that is in pretty much every police car nowadays. I remember when I was your age, they didn't have computers. They had to call everything in over the radar or over the radio just to find out if people had wants and warrants and things like that. And now police can pull up your whole record and everything, right from their computer. It's called an MDC or MDT, Mobile Data Terminal, mobile data computer, but it's really just a laptop. Anyway, one thing I'd like to mention too is people like to think that their juvenile records are not accessible, that law enforcement can't get to that. They can. It's not public record, but it's still in that computer. They can pull it up right there. Don't think that, especially if you're going in for a background check, that they won't find out about that kind of stuff. And if you lie about it, then you're just immediately disqualified. Here's some local police officers employed by department providing in-field computer access. And as you see, this is pretty prolific. Pretty much everybody, percentage-wise, it's almost 80% on most things. With regard to all of these different stuff, vehicle records, criminal history, prior calls. That's something too that people don't think about, but the police keep records of prior calls for service. So if they're called to your house a lot, each officer that shows up knows that. You're gonna get notes in there. And so, keep that in mind when you're doing things, especially if you're teenagers and having parties, maybe alternate whose house you have the party at or something. or just don't have really loud parties. And one of the best ways to avoid noise complaints is to invite your neighbors to your parties, because then they won't complain about you. They're having fun too. Implications of technology. There are some privacy issues with it, right? Some people are really concerned about this, that they're going to be invading their privacy, so to speak. I don't worry about it so much personally because I know that they have much more interesting people out there to spy on than me. And also, I don't have anything interesting for them to find. If you're worried about it, then that might be because you've got something to worry about. Even if doing something minor that you're not supposed to be doing, the likelihood of that, rising to the level where they're gonna use resources against it is pretty low. Effectiveness of it is another question. Like, is this gonna be effective? I'd say it's pretty effective. The costs, there are costs associated with it. Even with body cameras, the body cameras themselves are only like $500. But the real costs associated with using body cameras for departments is storing all of that data in a means to where you can retrieve it when you need it, but also have it stored securely. Because you think about, Atlanta PD or some large police department has, thousands of officers out on the street every day, at least hundreds of officers. I can't remember how many they, anyway. But then they're all out recording, several times a day. That's a lot of recordings that's got to be stored and backed up and also be able to be retrieved. And so they end up spending a lot of money on that sort of thing. And the body camera companies are happy to provide them with cloud services and things to store that in for a fee. So keep that in mind too. That's a big cost of that, as well as pretty much everything else associated with cost as well. You always got to look at the cost-benefit analysis. All right. Well, anyway, well, that's the end of what I have for that. This is the last lecture, and I hope you all enjoyed the class. Please don't forget to do your course evaluations. Nobody ever does them in online classes, but I'd like to know what all you all enjoyed and what you didn't. More so, what you enjoyed, because usually students are happy to tell me what they didn't like. But anyway, I hope you all had a good class. Hopefully I'll see some of you in some face-to-face classes someday. If you ever need anything, then just let me know. I'm an email away, and my office is right in here at the Social Science Building. I hope you all have a good break here after the end of the summer. And with that, I will say adieu.